Yeah, I thought I would include a little collage of my life. At 1973, I got to Belize with Norman Hammond, who, part of Cambridge University now, but before he retired, he was at Boston University, and I met him because I started my archaeological career in England, in Hertfordshire, and then in Suffolk. And oddly, that's how I got to Belize, which was then British Honduras. So at Lamanai, well, I married another archaeologist, which I said I'd never do, but I did. And there I am washing nappies in the lagoon at Lamanai. Glass washboards, that's the best, I learned. See what you can learn in archaeology. And so the others are just snapshots of what I've done over the years until now I'm retired and aged, but haven't given up yet. One of the things I just wanted to mention was I made every attempt to cite all the original sources of my images, but in some cases it was really hard because images are often copied and copied on the web, but I did my best, so contact me for information if there's a source that I don't always have a citation under the source, and I can let you know. Masters of Time, the Maya. Now, I should emphasize, of course, that the Maya are living today in Central America. There are about 8 million Maya. The name Maya is our term. They actually have different names for different cultural groups, different ethnic groups, but that will come up a bit later. So I always like to show a photograph of an active Maya community, and this is the highlands of Guatemala, where this happens to be a flower market, and the women still preserve for the market their traditional dress and their weaving. And this is from a book by Thor Jansen. If any of you are interested, he has wonderful photographs of the Maya area. Now, there's a long tradition of British involvement in the Maya world, and it's really sad that I'm the last in all of the United Kingdom. And they're hiring for my position now, but I don't know if they'll continue this tradition, which is sad. The books that introduced the Maya area to, I guess you could say, the modern world were The Incidents of Travel, in Central America, Incidents of Travel in Yucatan, written by an American and a British illustrator, Frederick Catherwood. And Catherwood did all of the illustrations and the really beautiful illustrations of many of the ruins, and many of the people here in England and in Europe is how they became aware of Maya civilization in Central America. And for us Mayanists, Eric Thompson is an epigrapher and an archaeologist, which is pretty hard to do these days. And he was one really of the founders of Maya research in the world. And a lot of his excavations, the materials in the British Museum, and he did some of the foundational work on Maya epigraphy, deciphering the hieroglyphs. And here he is with the Lacandon Maya of Chiapas. There was a wonderful exhibit years ago in the Royal Academy of the British and the Maya. And I always hoped that they would have another, but it's interesting that it seems to me the British have forgot about the Maya and about Belize and about British Honduras. Most people, when I say where I work, they don't know what I'm talking about. And often when the BBC calls me or television stations they're going to do a documentary about the Maya, they go to Mexico or Guatemala. And I always ask, well, you're English, British, why don't you go to Belize? And they usually say, Belize? You know, no knowledge at all of this long history of involvement. And then, of course, Scotland as well. Ewan Mackay, who's recently passed away, worked at one of my favorite sites in Belize, Shenantaniche. And the Scots were very, very active in Belize for many years. It seems that as if with independence, that's gone downhill a little, although geographers and ecologists in Scotland are very active in Belize, but not archaeology anymore. Okay, so it's just some terms. Middle America is the term we use. It's a geographical term, And that refers to the area more or less between Texas and the U.S. Southwest and South America. We just say Middle America. It's geographical. Central America is actually a political term, or it has become a political term. And it refers to all of the countries in Middle America except Mexico, which politically considers itself North America. The term that we use the most is Mesoamerica. And it was defined by archaeologists, anthropologists, and it refers to an area that shares a series of cultural traits. So it has some meaning for us, and we're going to go over those. For those of you who might not know much about Mesoamerica, you probably have heard of some of these groups. You see, I've marked the Maya area there. The Olmecs are the purple area. They're probably the earliest civilization in Mesoamerica, and their earlier dates are being pushed back. Now we say 1700. I expect it will go back to 2000 BC. Central Mexico had several civilizations. Tenochtitlan, you're probably the most familiar with. That was the Aztec capital in 16th century. The major city in central Mexico was Teotihuacan. And I'll talk a little bit about Teotihuacan. It was a large and very dense populous city between about, I said 250 there, probably 150 to 600 when it declined. And another major area, Oaxaca, where you have the Zapotecs and the Mixtecs, but there are hundreds of groups in Mesoamerica. I just thought I would introduce a few to kind of anchor you. Environmentally, in the Maya area itself, we use these terms, the highlands, because it's mountainous, the Pacific coastal plain, and then you drop down to the tropical area, the southern and the northern lowlands. The southern lowlands is the most humid. As you move north in the Yucatan Peninsula, it gets a bit drier, but it's still considered semi-tropical. And we use the term Yucatan, and we use it kind of loosely because there is a state of Mexico. You probably know this, the state of Yucatan is right there. So sometimes we use it to mean the state, and sometimes we use it to kind of mean the whole peninsula. It's a little confusing even among us. So politically, the Maya area includes Mexico east of the Isthmus of Tehuantepec, which you can see there, Guatemala, Belize, where I work, and western Honduras and El Salvador. Okay. And you might say, what makes it Maya? Essentially, there's really two things. The linguists really created the use of the term because in studying the languages of those present-day countries, they realized they're all related to a root language that probably existed between 2 and 3,000 BC. So all of the Maya languages are related. They're not mutually intelligible. It's a bit like all of the languages in Europe are ultimately Indo-European. It doesn't mean that they're mutually intelligible, but it tells us that they had common roots. So that is how we use Maya. And then today, many of the indigenous groups in different areas of of Yucatan and Belize and Guatemala and Mexico use the term as a unification term as well. But in the past, it was not used. And we'll go over that when I talk about the historic period. There really was no term called Maya. That's a little bit about the chronology. Most of what I talk about will be the classic period, probably. A little bit about the post-classic. And I have post-classic. Where do these terms come from? Because the first people from Europe who went to study the ruins thought the Maya ruins looked like classical Greece. So that's where the name classic came from. And then we were so inventive. The earlier dates, earlier period, we called pre-classic. And then post-classic, and it hasn't changed very much. So I'll go over some of the features that define the Maya, and to some extent, well, Mesoamerica as a whole. And these are important, I think. The first is that all the buildings are arranged around plazas or patios. Okay, they're not arranged along streets, in our sense of the word. They're built around plazas would be the big public spaces, and patios would be was what we call the smaller spaces that occur in residential units. So that's very characteristic. And I just included some sites here, Nakum, Lamanai. Although Lamanai, this is a little deceptive because it looks like it was surrounded by forest, and it wasn't. That's just the area that wasn't excavated. But this map here of Cajal Pech gives you a good idea, too, of this organization around plazas. Number two, they use what we call platforms to support buildings, which is logical in the tropics, right? Because it rains. When you live there, there's nothing better than being lifted a little bit out of the, not just out of the rain, though. One of the things I found was that when the rains come, a lot of the insects are on the move. And if you're up on a little platform, they'll avoid you. Some of them will avoid, especially the ants sometime. I've seen them come up and then go, ah, okay, and they go around. They don't come actually in the house. So platforms are very practical in the tropics. And the monumental buildings, they simply have more terraces. And I know people call the really high buildings pyramids, but I like to avoid that because they're not really pyramids, they're platforms. Pyramids were purpose-built mortuary monuments. And Maya buildings are part of the city. They were part of settlement. And but they did use the terrace technique to give greater height to the buildings. And then usually they supported buildings, chambered buildings, but in some places they supported just an altar. And the lower left there is Altenhauer. My husband worked for many years. And there, one of the major buildings, the platform at the top, there was just an altar, around the altar. So it must have been a public public ritual. And then I just included a domestic structure. This is probably a storage building, but you can see that it's also on a platform. Writing, okay. Almost all cultures of Mesoamerica had some form of writing. The Maya were the most advanced, and that's what we're going to talk about. We use the term codex to refer to the books that the Maya produced. And the difference between them and our books, we fasten them along one margin, whereas the Maya folded them like an accordion. And this is a page from a codex called the Dresden. And they've taken the names from the cities where they ended up. There were only four. Four books out of all of those years, Maya civilization, illiterate culture, hundreds, thousands of books, only four. The Spanish friars burned as many as they could. Paper doesn't preserve well anyway, but the Maya did suffer even more than the Aztecs, which is an interesting story, from the burning of books. But the Maya had the most advanced writing system, the most complex throughout Mesoamerica, and we'll learn a little bit about that, but mostly we will look at timekeeping. Any of you who have traveled through Central America probably know something about the ruins and about the stelae, the stone monuments, on which they recorded mostly information about the rulers, okay? The rulers and what their ancestry, presumably to justify their position. About Maya writing, it's not an alphabet. It's like Egyptian hieroglyphs. It's a syllabary. So the symbols represent vowel consonant combinations. They also had symbols that could represent whole words, but it was largely a syllabary. And I know you might not be able to see this very well, but it's from an introduction to Maya hieroglyphs, which if you're at all interested, it's aimed at anyone who wants to learn about Maya hieroglyphs, and you can download it from the web. So maybe at the end I can put together sort of a sheet where you can get all of this information about what to access. But this is a sheet from the introduction to Maya hieroglyphs. Just to show you along here, you have, for example, ch, which is the consonantal sound, and here you have the vowels. So this would be cha, che, chi, cho, and chu. So those symbols, again, are not just pretty pictures. They're actually a syllabary. And I just threw in a couple of examples. Here you have Siya Ha, which means he was born. And this is the Si, And to emphasize this y sound, that they add a complement here, see, ya, ha. And si is the root of the intransitive verb. That's the most important part, I guess you could say, to be. Like Egyptian hieroglyphs, the Maya had these phonetic complements that helped you see how the word should be pronounced. And then the ha is a grammatical suffix, and it indicates the tense, like the past tense. And a bakab is a position of someone in court among the Maya, and this is another example. This is ba, and the comb here is ka, ba, and that becomes bakab. Now, they also have variations on the symbols. Like here you see a comb, here you see what we would say is a little fish. And so if you're going to learn hieroglyphs, you have to learn all these different forms of the syllables. But they're pretty. Every year we have had a Maya hieroglyphic workshop at UCL, but this will depend on my successor. But if it goes ahead, I'll stay in touch with Simon and tell you how to get in touch. We have a 3-day workshop on the weekend to begin to learn hieroglyphs, and it's become quite popular and very successful. Okay, so that's writing, number 3. Number 4, rules of engagement in war. And I will talk more about this when we talk about human sacrifice. The Maya and other groups in Mesoamerica shared some aspects of rules of engagement in war, and that the emphasis was on capturing elite lords to appropriate their wealth. They did not kill on the battlefield. And that will go into this in more detail because it's fascinating. So the rules of engagement in war were in some ways very similar to ours, and in other ways very different. This is a mural from a site called Bonampak in Chiapas, Mexico, and you can see the warriors, the soldiers, holding lances. So almost like the samurai, it was very important to have hand-to-hand combat. But then this is true in many places, even in medieval Europe, right? Before the bow and arrow, before long-distance killing, the importance was on fighting individuals and overcoming them. So the rules of engagement, we will deal much more with that later. The practice of auto-bloodletting among rulers is also was practiced among Maya. They usually pierced the tongue or the earlobe, and the blood dropped on paper. Here you can see Lady Shok piercing her tongue, and the blood is falling on the paper, and they would burn that. The man standing over her is her husband. I didn't know whether, I don't think this would offend you, but this is a rollout scene from a vase, and also the foreskin of the penis was pierced in some ceremonies, and blood was let. This is actually a dancing ceremony, so I don't know, maybe it didn't hurt that much. Number 6, the cardinal directions. They had a concept of the cardinal directions, the Maya, as we do, right? North, south, east, and west. But they also emphasized a center. And the directions were often represented as colors. And I don't know if you can see that. North is white, east is red, south is yellow, and west is black. And the center was a turquoise blue-green. Very beautiful color, like the sea, like the Caribbean, and like the bodies of water that you see coming in and out of caves. And I just selected a page from the Madrid Codex, which it shows directional symbolism, and there are individual deities representing the north, south, east, and west. Number 7, astronomy and timekeeping. Again, most of the civilizations practice timekeeping, but the Maya were the most advanced in astronomical observation. And this is a photograph of a building at Chichen Itza that's believed to have acted as a place where timekeepers observed the heavenly bodies. I think if you've been there, I think it's probably true, given where the openings in the walls are. And the fact that they had to go out every night and observe the positions of the planets, of the stars, and record them. And we'll talk more about that too. Also deities, although I don't feel as comfortable talking about deities because actually at Conquest, the Spanish never asked the Maya about their religion because they were Christianizing. So a lot of the information about deities we infer from some of the literature, but I think it's difficult. But they are different from, let's say, Greek deities or Roman deities in that they can be male, they can be the same deity, can be male and female, and sometimes even are represented by an animal. And I used this moon deity, who's generally shown female, but sometimes as a young male, and the rabbit is the animal that represents the moon. And as some of you know, that's true in Asia as well, right? When you look at the moon in Asia, you don't see the man in the moon, you see a rabbit. Caves, very, very, very important in the Maya area. They're considered portals or entrances to the other world, and very important in myth and ritual. Because there are waterways in caves, and the water flows to the sea, and the sea is the other world. The other world is a watery world, right? So the caves are sacred because they connect the world that people live in with this other world, this other supernatural world. And if you've ever been in any caves in the Maya area, it is astounding, really. I was taken originally by Barbara McLeod and C.J. Russian, who were then working with the Peace Corps and the Belize government, and they were cave explorers. I could never do it, you know. They just put themselves on Land Rover tire tubes and, oh, this is a new cave, there's a river, let's go. And, you know, they fall over waterfalls. I don't know how they do it. So I was very happy to be shown by such experts. And some of the rooms in caves are, you can't tell the top from the bottom. They're stunning, they're crystalline, they're all different colors. But at heart, I'm not a caver, I'm too scared. But it's an amazing world. Only one of these photos is mine, the one on the lower right, and that was where Barbara and CJ, and we stayed 3 days exploring this cave. And the association with the sea is very interesting because if you go to a cave, you will see seashells. The Maya put scattered seashells on the path through the cave. So there's a strong association with caves as well in the sea and the other world. Swidden farming, but this was practiced all over Europe, so it's nothing new, but it is one of the major tropical means of farming and subsistence, where a field is cleared with burning. So you can see that here. This is an interesting photo from the air to show once the fields have been cleared and burned. They still use a digging stick. It's how they plant the fields. And here's one showing maize or corn. It's still widely practiced, although it is threatened by modern farming in which fertilizers and other chemicals are used. But it is still a good, environmentally sound kind of farming. It's often said that the fields are allowed to lie fallow after a couple of years, but I have a colleague, Annabelle Ford, who's been working a long time with the Maya in central Belize, and it's more complicated than that, because what happens is other plants grow up and they manage crops and they manage tree crops on these fields successively. And it's one of the things that was not realized when people from Europe first went to Mesoamerica, which is that the forests look wild, but they're actually managed. It's another sort of form of agriculture. What's known as the triumvirate, Mesoamerican triumvirate, and also with the Maya, corns, beans, and squash formed a really important basis of the diet. And it's said that they provide all of the necessary nutrients, including proteins. And this is because, some of you may know, the corn kernels are soaked in lime before they're made into a flour. And that process makes nutrients available, proteins, certainly calcium, niacin, that are not available in fresh corn. So with that treatment, it really revolutionized the diet. And yes, when you want to snack, Doritos are more nutritious than crisps. The ball game, the last feature. Some of you probably have heard the ball game was played throughout Mesoamerica and among the Maya, different kinds of ball game, different kinds of courts. But essentially, it was a cross between volleyball and squash. It wasn't like football where you had an end zone. You really had to get the ball beyond the center line. And if it landed on the ground, then the other team got the point. And it's often been said, Chichen Itza, that they tried to get the ball through this ring, but most of us don't think so. That probably marked the center line and may even have had a net or something across it, but not getting a ball through the net. So one thing, I wanted to pick one feature of Maya civilization. So I thought we'd talk about the calendar. And I know this looks a little busy, but I think the calendar is fascinating. So they have an absolute count the way we do. We call theirs the long count, but they have a starting date and time, and they count time from that starting date just as we use the birth of Christ. So it's pretty much the same. Their starting date in our calendar is equivalent to 3,114 BC. Now you might say, okay, so what happened then? We don't know. We don't know. But it was probably similar, perhaps, to our own civilization, in which there was an important event or an important person born, and that date was marked, and the time is proceeds from that particular date. And also, like our dates, and here I have 2023, place where those numbers are in place tells us something about the date. So we move, I guess you would say to the left. So the 3 would be 3 times 1 year, 2 is 2 times 10 years, 0 times 100 years, and 2 times 1,000. So there's a place for these numbers that enable us to tell in our terms what year it is. And the same is true with the Maya, where they've placed their numbers. The big glyph on the top tells you that they are going to introduce one of these long count dates. And so the glyphs in the red box refer to the number of days that have passed. It is a count of days. It is not a count of years. This is very important, because even my colleagues will often talk about years, but they no years, okay? They didn't use that term. It's a count of days. And they're organized into cycles of time, just as ours are. And it's kind of like, as I say, our 365 plus days are called a year to us, and 10 of our years are called a decade. So those are examples of how we label cycles, and the Maya did exactly the same. So what did the Maya call these cycles, and how much time do they stand for? And after this, you will be able to go to a Maya site and you will be able to read the glyphs and tell the date, I promise. A baktun was 144,000 days. Now, I guess I should say at first that generally these units or these cycles generally are multiples of 20, except when you go from the months to tunes, which for some reason is not a multiple of 20, and we don't know exactly why that's true. But once you get to the tune, which is 360 days, you multiply it times 20, and you get the katun, which is 7,200 days, you multiply that times 20, you get 144,000 days for the baktun. So these are all, these symbols represent these cycles of time on the Maya monuments. The baktun, the katun, the tune is close to what we would call a year. The weenal is close to a month, monthly, I guess you could say, spans of time. And the keen is one day, like ours. So in our system, we have a similar way that we divide up time. We have a day as well. That's the main one, from sunrise to sunset. We have a week, which is a cycle of 7 days, recurring cycle. We have a month, which can be anywhere from 28 to 31 days. And we have the year, and this is where I will get back to this because it's interesting. Our year is 365.25 blah, 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 blah days. So it's not, strictly speaking, a count of days. And this has to do with what we call the solar year, and I'll get back to that. But we do have a decade, which is 10 years. We have a century, which is 10 decades or 100 years, and we have a millennium. We don't go beyond that, but the Maya did. They went way beyond a cycle of just 1,000 years, the equivalent of days in 1,000 years. So these are the names of the cycles in the long count, Baktuns, Katuns, Tuns, Winal, Keen. But what about numbers? They had only three symbols. A dot represented one, a bar represented five, and there was a symbol for zero. So they're one of the two civilizations that invented zero. And the other was the Indus Valley civilization that invented zero. So it was quite an accomplishment. And here you can see a list of the bars and the dots. And zero varied. This, I think, is the most common, but you do see other. But the scribes were allowed a little bit of fun with all of these symbols. So in our system, we have 10, right? From 0 to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And these are our symbols, and we call them Arabic. I think they're actually from South Asia, but they came to Europe through the Arab world. So at this point, we know the names of the Maya cycles of time, we know the symbols, and you can actually read the long count date here. This initial series tells us, okay, a date's going to follow. You have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 baktuns. This is a zero symbol, which you would know if you had your little introduction to hieroglyphics guide with you. And that's 0 times 7,200 days. This is the tune, which is the 360 days. And there's 19, 3 times 5 is 15, plus 4 is 19, times 360 days. And the 2 winals is 2 times 20, and 4 keens is 4 days. And that adds up to 1,302,884 days since 3114 BC. And in our calendar, this brings us to AD 454. So the good thing about working in the Maya area is that we have dates. Obviously, not we don't get them everywhere, but they have provided a really good basis, especially for ceramic chronology. And this is what we call a stela, a carved monument from the site of Yaxchilan. Now, this is the fun part. What about getting to the actual day, such as the day of our week or the day of our month? Yes, they do tell us on these stelae about the day of the week and the day of the month. And there I've highlighted them in the red squares. So Tu Khan refers to the number 2 associated with the day name, Khan, and 4 is associated with the month of Zots. The month is easier to understand because they're like our months. Their week is a little more complicated. They called their weekly cycle the Dzolkin. And that's what the Tu Khan refers to. So it's a bit like saying Thursday, the fifth day of the week, as Thursday is day number 5. They had a monthly cycle, which they called the Hab. And 4 Zots refers to the fourth day in the month of Zots, a bit like the 18th of January or any of our dates of months. Now, the Maya Dzolk'in is more complicated than our week, but it's not difficult to remember because I did it for a while. And when you get used to it, it's fine. You can keep up with it. The Maya Hab is just like our months. So if we have the two calendars, our calendar has a weekly cycle based on days numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, combined with 7 named days. And we call that the week. The Maya have a similar system that they call the Dzolk'in. Theirs is more complicated because they have numbers 1 to 13, which they alternate with 20 day names. So it's a little bit more complicated. The monthly cycle, we have 12 named months of different lengths. That can be 28 to 31 days. The Maya Hab, all of their months are 18 except for one at the end. Or 18 months had 20 days except for one at the end that just had 5 days. So we can almost see it approximating what we might call the solar year. So, but before we look at the Dzolk'in and the Hab, I'd love this to look at our weekly and monthly cycles. And day 1 is the day of the sun, and day 2 is the day of the moon. They come from the Anglo-Saxon heritage. Day three is the day of Tuesday. It's a Scandinavian. I don't know if it's a god or a goddess. Maybe you know better than I. Day four is the day of Woden, Wednesday. Day five of Thor. Day six of Frigge. And day seven of Saturn. So our days are named after gods. And that has stuck even through proselytization by the Christians in the early Christian period, which I find fascinating, that people would not change the names of their days. And our cycle, day one, is always Sunday. We don't change. We don't change the cycles of numbers with the name days. But as I said, with the Maya, they do. But what's interesting is they consider the last day of any cycle, like the last day of the month or the last day of the Tzolk'in, as also the seeding of the next cycle. And in a way, we do that too, because Sunday is part of the weekend, but it also kicks off the next week. So that concept of seeding, I think we actually have as well. Now, we don't know where the Maya Tzolk'in days names come from. They don't seem to be gods, so we're not sure. So these are the 20-day names of the Tzolk'in, the Maya week. The spelling changes if you get into this at all, because the epigraphers are always deciding that they're going to change the pronunciation, change the spelling to be more accurate pronunciation, so it can get aggravating after a while. But these are the 20-day names, Imish, Ik, Ak, Bal, Khan, all the way down to Ahau. And for example, in this list, Ahau is spelled with an H, A-H-A-W, and recently now they spell it with a J, A-J-A-W. So these are the names of the days. And I'm sorry that this can't be larger, but I'm going to have to redraw all of the day names myself. But what you would do then is you would pair one with the first named day, Imish, 2 Ik, 3 Akbal, 4 Khan, 5, 6, 7, until you get to 13, Ben. And then there are still 7 day names left, so you start again with 1, Ish, 2 Men, 3 Kib, 4 Kaban, Etznab, Kawak, Ahau, and then you run out of day names, so you start again with 8 Imish, 9 Ik, and then that goes on until the cycle repeats itself every 260 days, 13 times 20, and it repeats the cycle again. So that's the Maya week. And this is how it's usually shown in the literature by my colleagues, with this wheel representing the numbers, 1 to 13, this representing the 20-day names here. So this shows 8 Ahau, and then it's linked up with the months. But I like to say it's very much like what I call the Anglo-Saxon calendar wheel, which is very similar. You have, here I've used July, but our Anglo-Saxon week here is day of the sun, number one, day of the moon, number two, and it's the same. It's just that our weekly calendar is less complicated than the Maya calendar, but it's the same concept. Now our months, which the Maya months is called the Hab, in a way it's like ours, although we don't know where their names come from either, but we do know where ours come from. They come from the gods, they come from deified emperors, and then 4 of the names are the result of either an emperor or a pope, probably, changing or trying to adjust the timekeeping that we have to the calendar year. But originally September was the 7th month in a cycle, and now for us it's the 9th month. So September, October, November, December, as you know, are from Latin names for numbers. But the rest of the names are gods and goddesses, usually Roman, and here Julius Caesar and Augustus Caesar. So again, it interests me that even in the evangelization process in Europe, that there's only one country that changed its weekdays, and it's, I'm not sure about the month's days, and that's Portugal. But all of the rest still have names after deities of our culture. So these are the Maya months, Pop, Wo, Sip, Sots, and they're 18 months of 20 days, plus, as I said, 5 days at the end. So it's the same concept as our months in that the days are juggled, right? They juggle the monthly numbers to meet a particular cycle. Now, you know why our months consist of different numbers of days. Even though, like many civilizations on Earth, know that the Earth and the Sun come back to the same relative position in about 365 plus days. Okay. Now we say now that the Earth revolves around the Sun, but you don't have to know that to keep track of where, you know, the planetary bodies. All you have to know is that the cycles are repeated and that the Earth and the Sun, after a period of time, come back to the same relative position. We, that's called the solar cycle, or in English, the year. So at some point, people in the West decided they wanted the cycle of months to be coordinated with the solar cycle. So in other words, they wanted on the first day of January, the Sun and the Earth had to be in the same relative position so that when the next day 1 January occurred, they were in that same position. We were concerned, probably this has to do with bringing a lot of societies together under a timekeeping system. I'm not sure. But with the Maya, this wasn't true. So we had to juggle the months to make our monthly cycle coordinate with the positions of the Earth and the Sun in the same way every year. And this is why a day is added to February, but you know all this. So the Maya were certainly aware of the planetary movements, but they did not try to match their monthly or weekly cycle to the cycle, to the relative positions of the Sun and the Earth. They followed it, of course. They had astronomers to follow it, but they didn't keep time in the way that we do. And some people say, how did they know? How did ordinary people know? Well, we don't know. I don't go out to Greenwich and observe the stars. I have my phone or a calendar on my wall, and somebody else keeps track of time, and I go, okay. And it was pretty much the same for the Maya. They had experts, they had astronomers who tracked the heavens and kept time. So back to our inscription. Any Maya inscription then with this long count date, this is a slightly... it's the same one from Yaxchilan, 9-0-19-2-4. That's how we write the Baktuns, Katuns, Tuns, Winals, and Kin. And then the weekly cycle, or the Dzogchen, and the monthly cycle. And the start date, I said, was 31-14 BC, but it was actually a specific day 4 of the week Ahau and day 8 of the month Kumku. And in our calendar, this is the 17th of October, 454 AD. So I like to talk about that because often we think that some of the Mesoamerican civilizations are not so advanced, but the Maya were very advanced in terms of astronomy. And the Europeans made a mistake that the Maya did not make. And this is that in Europe, for many centuries, people believed that the positions of the planets and the sun was geometric, you know, circular orbits. So when there were observations, they spent time trying to fit those observations into this idea of a harmonious geometric universe with the planets following circular orbits, which, as you know, Kepler's discovery in 1609 that the orbit of Mars was elliptical kind of, you know, said, whoa, through that. But the Maya never made that assumption. They just based their calendar on observation, and they recorded the positions of the heavenly bodies every day, every night especially. They observed the night sky and the movements of the heavenly bodies. Well, I say hundreds here, it was originally thousands of years. So it's really quite an achievement. Why didn't we learn from that? I say, you know, what have the Maya given us? I don't know. Why do you think? I don't know. It astounds me when I think about it, about how all of the knowledge wasn't passed on. But do you have any questions?